viewers and my dear students, I welcome you all in my surgery online class. And today topic of discussion is cholecystectomy. So it is a congenital anomaly. The cyst is formed in the prenatal phase or after the delivery, but it commonly occurs between the children's of the age 1 to 2 years. So it is common among females and in children. We cannot say them children, infants. Between the 1 to 2 years, so it is a congenital cyst, and this cyst is formed in the biliary tree, basically in the common bile duct. This is the biliary tree. So the cyst is formed in the bile duct network. Commonly in the common bile duct. This is common bile duct. So this is the network of the bile ducts. This is the bile ducts. These are the ducts in the liver. These are hepatic ducts. This is liver. This is gallbladder beneath the liver. Gallbladder beneath the liver. This is stomach. This is duodenum. And this is pancreas. So this is the network of the bile ducts. Bile ducts inside the liver. These are the hepatic ducts. Then these hepatic ducts travel to the gallbladder, and from gallbladder it travel into the pancreas and into the duodenum. So these are the pancreatic ducts. This is the pancreatic ducts, and these are the hepatic ducts, and this hole is biliary tree, the bile ducts, network of bile ducts. So the congenital cyst occurs in the bile duct, basically in this area, common bile duct. So this is a congenital cyst. Now what happens, as we all know, what is the function of bile ducts? What they do? They carry bile. The bile is produced in the liver, and from liver the bile ducts carry bile into the gallbladder and then into the pancreas and in duodenum, and where it get excreted, and that's how the digestion occurs. The bile gets traveled from liver into the duodenum, that is in the intestine, through the bile ducts. So that's how the process of digestion occurs, and then excretion occurs. So bile contains what? Bile contains bilirubin, bile contains cholesterol, that are important in digestion, and the excess of that gets eliminated or excreted from the body. So that's how the digestion occurs. So bile is very important. We have already seen the bile storage occurs in the hepatic liver canculi, the small canals present inside the liver, and also the storage is done by gallbladder. So now the cholecystectomy cyst, first we have to understand the etiology. The cause of cholecystectomy cyst. Now what happens? There could be early canalization, premature canalization. So premature or early canalization of the ducts, of the bile ducts, and then obstruction, that is prenatal obstruction of the, or the prenatal ducts obstruction. So basically these reasons are given in every book, that there is early canalization of the bile ducts, and then that causes the obstruction of the bile ducts, and that will result in increased proximal pressure of the bile ducts, and then this will result in the weakening of bile ducts wall. So that's how the proximal pressure increases, and that will result in the weakening of the wall of the bile ducts, and that weakening will further causes dilatation of the common bile duct. So that's how the dilatation occurs in the ducts, and that will result in the cyst formation. Beside this reason, there could be prenatal infections. So there could be infections, prenatal viral infections. Also, the abnormal pancreatico-biliary junction. This could be also the reason. Abnormal pancreatico-biliary junction. So the prenatal or early canalization of the bile ducts and the obstruction inside the bile ducts will result in high proximal pressure, and that will cause weakness or weakening of the wall, and that will result in dilatation of the ducts wall. Also, the abnormal pancreatic or biliary junction can lead to the colitical cysts, or the prenatal viral infections can also be the cause. So this is the etiology. Now the totally classification. First of all, I will focus on the symptoms. The symptoms patient will come with a triad. There is a triad of three symptoms present in colitocal cyst. So that triad is formed of three symptoms. First is pain. Pain in right hypochondrium. Liver is in right sided and gallbladder lies beneath the liver. So there is right sided hypochondrium pain. Then when you will examine the patient, during the examination, abdominal mass will be felt. So there is presence of abdominal mass. Now this mass has a typical character. It is soft, it is non-mobile or not mobile, it will not move with the respiration. So the mass is soft and not radiolucent, and it will not move with the respiration. It is not mobile. Beside this pain and abdominal mass, the very important symptom which makes the triad is obstructive jaundice. So due to the obstruction, there will be jaundice. So the features of jaundice will also be present, like fever, then yellowness of the skin and sclera, yellowish discoloration will be present. Beside this, dyspepsia and improper digestion, distension, then dyspepsia. All the features related to weak digestion will be present, and fever, because jaundice is there, and colitocal cyst can be, there could be presence of infection with it. So if infection is present, then there will be fever also. So this is the triad made up of right-sided hypochondrium pain, abdominal mass which is soft and not mobile and will not move with the respiration, and the obstructive jaundice with the distension and dysphagia. Other features could also be present, or we can say, or term them as complications. So the other features present are, there is pancreatitis, because that will cause inflammation of the pancreas. So pancreatitis, there could be cirrhosis of the liver, there could be portal hypertension. So what is portal hypertension? When the blood flow, when the pressure of the blood flow increases in the portal veins, so there will be portal hypertension, cirrhosis, pancreatitis. Now this colitopal cyst, the dilatation, the congenital dilatation of the common bile duct can result in the stasis of the bile. So that will also stimulate the formation of gallstones. So gallstones could also be. Then, yes, we have seen the obstructive jaundice also. Because if this cyst get ruptured, so that will cause peritonitis. If the cyst gets ruptured, so that will cause peritonitis, portal hypertension, pancreatitis, cirrhosis. Then there could be recurrent cholangitis. In exam, that could be asked as a small or brief question of 5 marks. What is cholangitis? It is the bacterial inflammation of the bile ducts. Bacterial inflammation. So the bacterial inflammation in the gallbladder or in the bile ducts is termed as cholangitis. So there could be recurrent cholangitis, and the very risky complication could be the formation or due to the malignant changes in the colitopal cyst. So if the malignant changes occur, then that will result in cholangiosarcoma. So pancreatitis, cirrhosis of the liver, portal hypertension, that is the increased blood flow pressure in the portal veins, gallstones because of the stasis of bile due to the colitopal cyst, then peritonitis if the cyst get ruptures, recurrent cholangitis and cholangiosarcoma if the malignant changes occurs. So these are the complications, or patient may come with this features also with the triad. So with that 3 symptoms, these features can also be present, but that triad is present in 80% of the patients. Now the classification, which is very important in colitopal cyst. This classification is known as Todini classification. Todini classification. So according to this classification, there are 5 types of colitopal cyst. So you will understand each one by one. So this is the first one. I'm just cleaning it because now the first classification is this is liver. This is the duodenum. This is the liver, this is the duodenum. This is the liver, this is the types, because the fifth is known as Caroli disease. So I will take it laterwards. So here I am making the 4 types of classification. So this is the liver. This is the liver, duodenum, liver. Now, this is the intrahepatic and extrahepatic ducts. This is gallbladder. Now, what happens? This is intrahepatic and extrahepatic ducts. This is gallbladder. Now the dilatation will occur here in the common bile duct in a fusiform manner. See how this gets dilated. So here the common bile duct has get dilated in fusiform manner. This is the fusiform dilatation. Fusiform dilatation of common bile duct. This is the first classification, the fusiform dilatation of the common bile duct. This is the first variety of the colitopal cyst. Now in second, see this is the extrahepatic ducts and intrahepatic ducts. This is the common gallbladder. Now here, the diverticulum will be formed of the common bile duct. See. This is gallbladder and here a diverticulum will be formed. So this is the diverticulum. The lateral secular diverticulum of the common bile duct will be formed because it is laterally. So lateral secular diverticulum is given the term to this condition. See, here the dilatation of the common bile duct is occurring in the fusiform manner. So it is fusiform dilatation of the common bile duct. This is the first category. In second classification, there will be formation of diverticulum beneath the gallbladder. See, this is common bile duct and here the diverticulum is formed. In third, this is the intra and extra hepatic ducts. This is the gallbladder. Now here the dilatation of the common bile duct will occur inside this duodenum. So the intraduodenal segment of the common bile duct will get dilated. See. So this is the intraduodenal segment of common bile duct. So the dilatation of intraduodenal segment of common bile duct. This is the third. In fourth, fourth is classified into two types, the A and the B. This is the hepatic ducts intra and. So in the A, the fourth classification in the A, there will be both intra and extra hepatic dilatations. So see, there will be, see how these dilatations are occurring. So there are intra hepatic and this is gallbladder. So there will be both intra derivations. In the fourth A. In the fourth B, this is lever and this is the duodenum. So there will be ducts are normal, there is no dilatation. Only the extra hepatic dilatations. This is the fourth B. So, you have to remember the classification very seriously. There are five types of classification. Here I have mentioned the four types. The fifth I will take later because that one is known as Caroli disease. So the first classification where the dilatation of the common bile duct in a fusiform manner, there is fusiform dilatation. See how the dilatation has occurred of common bile duct. So in a fusiform dilatation of the common bile duct. In second, there is diverticulum formed of the common bile duct. In third, there is dilatation of the intraduodenal segment of common bile duct. See, there is dilatation of the intraduodenal segment of the common bile duct. It is also known as, this third one is known as choledococele. This is the dilatation of intraduodenal segment of the common bile duct, is also known as choledococele. This third classification. Fourth is categorized into A and B. In fourth, there is intrahepatic and extrahepatic dilatations. In fourth B, there is only extrahepatic dilatation. See, the internal ducts in the liver are normal. But here the dilatation of the intrahepatic ducts also occur. The fourth classification is known as Caroli disease. This is the liver and this is the duodenum and these are the intrahepatic and extrahepatic ducts. This is the gallbladder. So the all thing is normal. Common bile duct is here normal. Everything is normal. Extrahepatic ducts are normal. The dilatation occurs here inside the liver. Multiple cyst occurs. So there is intrahepatic dilatations. Intrahepatic dilatations. And that are multiple. So multiple cyst formation occurs inside the liver. This is liver. So this condition is known as Caroli disease. Caroli's disease. So I will take the treatment of Caroli disease first, then I will take the treatment of other conditions. This is the fifth category, fifth classification of the Todini. According to Todini classification, the fifth type of choledochal cyst where the multiple cyst occurs in the liver. There is dilatation of intrahepatic ducts. This is Caroli disease. Now in this case, because there is intrahepatic dilatations, we will remove the multiple cyst. It is not not easy to remove each and every cyst present in the liver. So we will remove the some part of the liver. So in treatment, we will do the surgery. We will remove the some part of the liver that is known as hepatectomy. Hepatectomy. And if the whole liver is, you know, filled with this multiple cyst and multiple dilatations of the intrahepatic ducts, then we will do the liver transplant. Liver transplant. So in each type of choledochal cyst, the treatment is different in each type. Now, ARCP is what endoscope is introduced inside the stomach, that is retrograde. So stomach, then it will enter into the pancreas, and so this is the phenomena. That's why this name is ARCP. CT scan, MRI, then cholangiography, then HIDA scan. So this investigations are done: MRI, CT scan, ERCP, then abdominal ultrasound, endoscopy ultrasound, intraductal ultrasound. Then ERCP is very nice test. Cholangiography will visualize the ducts, the bile ducts. Now the treatment in each variety of the cholelithiasis cyst, there is 5 type of cholelithiasis cyst. In the type 1, that is the fusiform dilatation of the common bile duct. See, this is the duodenum and this is the liver, and here this is the intrahepatic ducts, gallbladder, and the fusiform dilatation occurs. See, in the fusiform dilatation, we will do what? We will remove the cyst. This procedure is known as cholecystectomy. So earlier the cystenterectomy was done. Cystenterostomy. Earlier this procedure was done. Cystenterostomy, where the drainage of the cyst was done. Cyst was not removed. In earlier days, cyst was drained. This procedure is known as cystenterostomy. So in this procedure, cyst was drained, but that causes many complications, mainly the formation of cholangiosarcoma and recurrent cholangitis, that is the bacterial inflammation of the bile ducts. So because of the complications in every patient when after doing this procedure, so this procedure is now stopped. It is not done. Cystenterostomy, that is the cyst was drainage of the cyst. Now cyst is removed. So we will remove the fusiform dilatation. So after removing this cyst, this procedure is known as cholecystectomy. The cyst is removed. We will remove the cyst. After that, the reconstruction of the biliary tree is done. See how this is cyst removed. Now the reconstruction of the biliary tree will be done. So that is done in a fashion or in a manner. So the cholecystectomy is followed by reconstruction of the biliary tree, that is known as Roxane Y hepaticojejunostomy. So cholecystectomy is followed by Roxane Y hepaticojejunostomy, where the biliary tree is reconstructed in the first type, where the fusiform dilatation of the common bile duct has occurred. In the second variety, when the diverticulum is formed, if the diverticulum occurs, okay, in that case we will remove the diverticulum. So we will remove the diverticulum. And then we will enter the T tube here. So here I am making
diagram again, it will be easy for you. See, this is the gallbladder and this is the common bile duct. This is the duodenum. So here the diverticulum is formed. So we will do what? We will remove the diverticulum. We will excise it, remove it. Then we will enter the T-tube. So after that, T-tube insertion. T-tube is inserted to drain out the contents. And after draining, suturing is done. Then the common bile duct will be sutured. So three steps in case of second type, that is when the diverticulum is formed. In the third, when there is, this is the duodenum, and when there is intraduodenal, when there is dilatation of the intraduodenal segment of the common bile duct, that is known as colidocal sill. Colidocal sill. The third type. So we will do what? We will enter here the endoscope and we will do the procedure. That procedure is known as, so here we are talking about the treatment in case of colidocal sill. The treatment is known as endoscopic sphenecterotomy. Sphenecterotomy. Endoscopic sphenecterotomy is done in third type of colidocal cysts, which is known as colidocal sill, where the dilatation of the intraduodenal segment of the common bile duct occurs. In case of fourth, where the intrahepatic and extrahepatic dilatations of the common bile duct occurs, so in that case we will do what? It is not possible to remove each and every cyst present in the intrahepatic and extrahepatic ducts. So and sometimes the cyst wall is adherent to the portal vein. So portal vein get injured. The operation is risky. So we will not touch the posterior wall of the cyst. We will remove the mucosa of the cyst. That technique is known as Lilly technique. Lilly's technique. When the posterior wall of the cyst is not touched and the mucosa is removed. Besides this, when there is multiple cysts in the intrahepatic ducts or when there is extrahepatic dilatations, so we will do what? Hepatectomy. Or in some cases, the liver transplant. So, if there are multiple cysts present and it is not possible to remove each dilatation, the cyst, so we will do liver transplant. In the fifth type of colidocal cyst, I have already mentioned, that is Caroli disease, where the intrahepatic dilatations occur, we will go for the hepatectomy and the liver transplant.